Hi, can you first introduce yourself?
Yes, my name is Svinka Slatter. I am an assistant professor in the Department of Psychiatry at the University of California, San Diego. And I am the principal investigator of the WISE Lab at UC San Diego.
Great. Great institution. And being part of the University of California, you may also be interested in the fact that we just renewed our deal with the University of California. As you probably know, JMIR has a deal with the University of California that allows researchers to publish either free of charge if they don't have research funding in JMIR journals, or if they have research funding, it's being subsidized by the university with a contribution of $1,000 towards the article processing fee. So I guess you took advantage of that as well when you published your work.
I did, yeah, that's great.
We're very pleased that the University of California just has renewed that deal. So we're continuing to do that. So we want to talk about your work that you published in JMIR mHealth and uHealth, very interesting work that adds to the growing canon of work that shows the relationship between physical activity and cognitive performance.
So my lab at UC San Diego investigates the neural mechanisms by which modifiable lifestyle factors such as physical activity, sedentary time, fitness, and diet affect brain plasticity and cognition as we age, with a primary focus on trying to prevent Alzheimer's disease, so maintaining brain health to prevent Alzheimer's. A big focus of my lab is to learn whether the cognitive and the brain benefits that we have seen that are associated with physical activity and exercise done in lab settings can actually extend to the real world. So there's a lot of research showing that physical activity and exercise are good for the brain, but most of it has been done in lab settings. So I really want to learn about, you know, whether if we can take advantage of mobile technologies to actually see whether the same relationship exists in the real world. So we have developed interventions to investigate how the brain and cognitive function change when we use digital technologies to help people be more active in their own environments. But the next step for me was to see if we could capture associations of cognition and physical activity remotely, so that future interventions that are designed to prevent Alzheimer's disease or, you know, enhance cognition could actually use such technologies. This led me to collaborate with Dr. Rayanne Moore. She's an associate professor at UC San Diego as well. And she's the lead investigator in the study that we just published, because she had developed a set of smartphone-based cognitive tests that could, you know, allow us to measure cognition remotely. So in this study, I collaborated with Dr. Rayanne Moore, and we wanted to investigate if we could capture an association between daily fluctuations in cognition and physical activity using this smartphone-based cognitive test and fitness trackers while participants wore these in their free living environments for about 2 weeks. And if we were able to see that physical activity and cognition fluctuated together on a daily basis in the real world, then that would give us some useful implications for future interventional work, so that we can measure how changes in physical activity potentially could lead to changes in cognition that we can measure in natural environments. And this can help future lifestyle interventions by reaching more people, saving people time so they don't have to come to the lab, and so that more people can participate in this kind of research.
Can you walk us a bit through the actual testing process, the app that measures the cognitive performance?
In this study, we used, so people went home with a fitness tracker and with a smartphone that pinged them twice a day to do this test for 2 weeks. And one test was a test of what we call executive functions that measures your ability to inhibit automatic responses that the brain is kind of used to doing in an automatic way. And it's similar to a Stroop task. I don't know if you've heard about the Stroop task before. So it's very similar to that. And then the other one was a list learning task. This is a typical type of task that we use to measure memory functions. So people would see words and try to remember them. And then they would recall as many as they could.
I'm wondering what the compliance was here. If people get bothered twice a day to fill in that test.
Well, I know we had high compliance. It is on the paper. I can't recall from the top of my head, but we do have the numbers in the paper. But that leads to one of the caveats too, which is that participants got paid for each completed test. So that's something that we definitely need to take into account in future studies. You know, would people be as compliant if they don't receive some compensation for completing the tests?
And my understanding is that they were not specifically instructed to do physical activities during the 2 weeks. So they just did what they always did. And some, I guess, some worked out and some didn't so much.
Right. So this was an observational study. So we didn't ask anyone to change anything about their lifestyle. So it was just to observe how they moved in their environment using the fitness tracker. And if whether, you know, the daily fluctuations that they would experience in everyday life in terms of their physical activity would be associated with fluctuations in cognition. So it was not an intervention. We did not ask people to change anything about their life or their physical activity.
And that's exactly what makes the study novel, I guess, because, as you said, previous studies have focused on lab-based interventions and then measured what the effect on cognition is, whereas this was really a free-living environment, very natural environment. And what did you find?
So what we found was very interesting. We found that on days that the participants moved more or, you know, had more physical activity, they performed more effectively on a test of executive function. And then the days that they moved less, their performance on this task was worse. So we didn't have the findings related to memory performance. So it was specific to this executive function task. So where people got faster, more efficient at performing the task on the days that they were having more movement in their real everyday life.
Can you explain what executive function exactly means?
So executive functions are tasks that measure mental flexibility, rapidly switching between tasks, decision-making abilities, our abilities to multitask. Those are all examples of executive function. So it's an umbrella term that covers different things that our frontal lobe is in charge of, and it's higher cognitive functioning. So it has several domains. And what we measured in this study was rapid inhibition, automatically inhibiting things that our brain kind of wants to do. But so, you know, it's just more efficient at doing that task on days where people seem to be moving more.
And what did you conclude from the study and what are the implications?
I think that what is novel about this study is that, like we discussed before, we've seen these associations between physical activity and cognition in lab-based environments. And usually the way that cognition is measured is with paper and pencil tests that are, you know, the classical tests that we use as neuropsychologists. But what's unique about this study is that it extends the work and provides novel evidence that these associations between cognition and physical activity may be captured remotely when, you know, in everyday life using, you know, fitness trackers and this kind of smartphone-based cognitive tests. So it gives us a tool that we can potentially use in the future to deploy interventions that can take advantage of this so that we can measure cognition repeatedly over time when people are engaging in an intervention rather than, you know, usually when we do clinical trials, people come to the lab before the intervention starts, then maybe at the middle and at the end, and we can measure cognition with our paper and pencil tests. But if this holds up in, you know, in interventional work and we can see change over time, then it really allows us, it gives us a tool to be able to reach to more people and measure cognition, you know, in many more occasions repeatedly over time during the course of clinical trials. So that would be our next step.
Yeah, and there's a term we use for this kind of assessment. That's ecological momentary assessment, or EMA. And so the title of your paper contains that phrase as well, daily level association of physical activity and performance on ecological momentary cognitive tests in free living environments, a mobile health observational study. What are the next steps? Are you working to expand the study or test it in other kind of settings? Or what are your next research projects?
Yeah, I think that there's many things that can be done with, and there's a lot more to be done in this area. So we plan to try to see if this ecological momentary cognitive test can be used in interventions designed to increase physical activity to support brain health and cognitive health. So we want to see if, you know, we can capture change over time in these measures and if they are sensitive enough to actually be used in clinical trials. And, you know, there's also more kinds of tests that can be developed and are being developed. I know Dr. Ann Moore's group, they work a lot with this test, developing, you know, repeated measures, alternative forms of the test, and, you know, just basically testing different domains of cognition. And, you know, this is all very new science, so we're very excited and there's a lot to be done.
Very good. Thank you very much. And congratulations to your paper.